Our prayer and offertory this morning are dedicated to the memory of Gloria Barnes, who died last week. Gloria was the mother of our choir director, Kathy Schultz. This morning come to us from Kendall Gibbons, a UU minister currently serving the All Souls UU Church in Kansas City. In 2015, she received the UUA Religious Humanist Award, and these are her words this morning. Out of a community of diverse heritage and belief, we come together to share our hope and to create good in the world. The prophets of all traditions and times have taught us that we are called to mercy, generosity, and mutual care, and that to be great is to serve. We know that there can be no enduring happiness for humanity so long as suffering and want go unrelieved. Until all may be sheltered, none of us is truly home. May the power of our various faiths sustain us in this work, that we may be the hands of holy creativity and justice, and build together a better world. I'd like to introduce Reverend Valerie Mapstone-Ackerman. You were here about 2 years ago with us, and she is an ordained Unitarian Universalist minister, social worker, and social justice advocate, activist. Originally from a small town near Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Valerie earned her BS degree in psychology and business from the University of Pittsburgh, a master's in social work from the University of Michigan, and a master's divinity degree from Meadville Lombard Theological School, where she and Martin were classmates. She previously served in congregations in Michigan, Illinois, Oklahoma, and Pennsylvania, as well as serving as an itinerant preacher in New York, Kansas, Arkansas, Oklahoma, Vermont, Ohio, and Texas, and has served as chaplain and advocate for domestic violence victims in Oklahoma and New York. She and her spouse, Bill, will welcome granddaughter number 3 in March, and they currently live in a historic mansion in Peoria. And she will be doing the story for all ages, as well as our reading and sermon later on.
Good morning. So this is my story for all ages. I'd like to tell stories from the Buddhist tradition. Anybody ever hear of the Buddha? The Buddha? Yeah, great. So the Buddha has, there were lots of stories told about him, and each one is a lesson. So at the end of this story, I want you to tell me 2 things. Which person or character or animal in this story was really secretly the Buddha, and what's the lesson? If you could tell me that, okay? There's like a story there. So, this story is called The Monkey King. It goes like this. Once upon a time, the human king was taking a bath in the river. Can you imagine taking a bath in the river? Well, That's where he had to bathe. This was long ago before bathtubs were invented. So he was bathing in a river, and all of a sudden he noticed this mango that came by floating in the river, and he picked up the mango and he said, "This is the most beautiful mango I've ever seen." And he takes a bite and he said, "It's the most tasty mango I've ever had. I must find out where this mango came from. There must be a really awesome mango tree up the river." So he calls over his guards and he said, "Guards, go find the source of this amazing mango, because I would like to have more of them and I would like to share it with my kingdom." So off the soldiers go up the river looking for mango trees, and they see all kinds of trees, but they don't see any mango tree. And then all of a sudden they smell the delicious smell of mangoes, and they look up and there's this glorious huge mango tree just full of ripe fruit. So the first thing they do is start climbing the tree to pull these beautiful mangoes off. Well, that tree happened to be the home of some monkeys. And they were very afraid of these soldiers, and they thought, well, if these soldiers take all of the mangoes, what will we eat? We'll have to go into the forest and find other food. So the soldiers saw the monkeys starting to gather the mangoes, and instead of being kind to the monkeys, they started throwing the mangoes at the monkeys and harming them and knocking them into the river. Well, the monkey king called out to all of his monkey friends and said, "Let's get out of here before it's too late." And there was nowhere to go, that there weren't soldiers throwing things at them. And he realized that if he stretched really hard across the river and put his tail onto the branch where he was on the mango tree, he could make a bridge for all of the monkeys to escape. And that's exactly what he did. All of the monkeys escaped right across the Monkey King's back, and he leaped into the air and caught the tree and escaped with his whole little kingdom of monkeys. Well, as it happens, right about the time he did that, the king actually had finished his bath and had come upriver and found this mango tree where all of his soldiers were gathering mangoes. And he saw how brave the Monkey King was. He saw that the Monkey King had saved his whole kingdom with just one act of bravery. And he started thinking, maybe that wasn't really the way to handle this situation. Maybe I should have shared the mangoes with the monkeys instead of taking all of their food away. I'm inspired by this Monkey King, and I'm going to go back to my kingdom and be kinder to the people I rule, not be so bossy, share more, and take the example of the Monkey King. And that's the end of the story. We hope he actually did it. We don't really know. So who do you think the Buddha was? Where did the Buddha come sneaking into the story? What do you think? The Monkey King? I think you're right. I think it was the Monkey King, because he taught the lesson. What is the lesson? What do you think?
Be kind.
Be kind. That's perfect. That's exactly the lesson. Be kind instead of mean. We can all choose that, right? Thank you for listening to my story today.
And now we'll have the reading and sermon by Reverend Valerie Ackerman.
The reading today comes from The Engaged Buddhist Reader. It's a poem by the Vietnamese monk Thich Nhat Hanh. It's a very famous poem if you're into Buddhism. And if you're not, it might be new to you. "Don't say that I will depart tomorrow. Even today, I am still arriving. Look deeply. Every second, I am arriving to be a bud on a spring branch, to be a tiny bird with still fragile wings, learning to sing in my new nest, to be a caterpillar in the heart of a flower, to be a jewel hiding itself in a stone. I still arrive in order to laugh and to cry, to fear and to hope. The rhythm of my heart is the birth and death of all that is alive. I am the mayfly metamorphosing on the surface of the river.
and I am the bird that swoops down to swallow the mayfly. I am the frog swimming happily in the clear pond of water, and I am the grass snake that silently feeds itself on the frog. I am the child in Uganda, all skin and bones, my legs as thin as bamboo sticks. I am the arms merchant selling deadly weapons to Uganda. I am the 12-year-old girl, refugee on a small boat, who throws herself into the ocean after being raped by a sea pirate. And I am the pirate, my heart not yet capable of seeing and loving. I am a member of the Politburo, with plenty of power in my hands, and I am the man who has to pay his debt of blood to my people, dying slowly in a forced labor camp. My joy is like spring, so warm, it makes flowers bloom all over the earth. My pain is like a river of tears, so vast, it fills four oceans. Please call me by my true names, so I can hear all my cries and my laughter at once, so I can see that my joy and pain are one. Please call me by my true names, so I can wake up, and so the door of my heart can be left open, the door of compassion. That was called Please Call Me by My True Names by Thich Nhat Hanh. The other day, starts my message, the other day I was watching my local television station, watching the news, and the story was about how to find a fallout shelter. Who remembers fallout shelters? I can remember the first grade, 1963, that right outside of my first grade classroom, which was on the lowest floor of the school, was a sign for a fallout shelter, and I had to go down, you would have to go down into the basement to the fallout shelter. I already thought I was in the basement, but apparently there was another basement and they didn't let first graders go there. So I never saw the fallout shelter, but I knew where it was, and I knew why it was at 6 years old that I might need a fallout shelter. I do not remember ducking and covering. Does anyone remember actually being taught to duck and cover? Of all of those who raised their hands, does anyone think that will help you? There's a small chance somehow it might help, depending on how far away the nuclear bomb was dropping. Then when I was a little older, I lived in a different small town, and a friend of mine, Louie, lived on a dirt road that was called Nike Site Road. Nike Site Road. And I thought, huh, what an odd name for a road. And it wasn't until much later when I learned out what Nike nuclear missiles were that I lived right with the nuclear missiles. I lived with the ones we had right in my town. And my friend Louie lived on the road that led up to the Nike site. And that explained why there was this little group of military people living in this one little housing development in my town, always wearing their fatigues. I've never figured out why were there all these soldiers in my town, like maybe 20 of them with their families. It all added up later on when I became an anti-Cold Warrior. I became an activist at the urging of Helen Caldicott, who was an Australian pediatrician who was one of the first people to discover that there was a legacy from all of the testing of nuclear weapons. And part of it was finding strontium with some number, I don't remember, in the deciduous teeth of children. And she started asking for people all over the world to send their children's teeth to her after the tooth fairy visited so they could be tested. And sure enough, children the world over had nuclear isotopes detectable in their teeth from nuclear testing. Why does this bother us in this day and age? Well, it bothered the people of Hawaii recently when they were told that there was a missile headed their way. At first, we were told that it was an accidental message. And then we found out that the person who actually sent the message believed that a nuclear missile really was on its way. And why would he believe that in this day and time? Well, there's this fight going on between a couple of guys. I don't want to characterize them beyond saying they're a couple of guys. But that couple of guys having a big public fight over nuclear weaponry should be enough to bring us back to some consciousness about where we are in this strange, strange age. We're back in the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists has changed their clock again. I think it's 2.5 minutes to midnight right now. We'd gone all the way back to 11:45, not so long ago, and now we're ticking back up toward midnight because of this new nuclear age that we're in. And there are calls to beef up our nuclear weaponry and maybe actually downsize our weaponry. There's another idea to like make them really small so we'll have just little nuclear blasts and can only kill one city's worth of people. These are the things that are in the news on a daily basis. Our kids might be hearing about it, if we're hearing about it. But of course, there are many, many other things going on that are worthy of our attention and our worry. There are people in your community, as you know, because you donated today, who don't have homes and are cold in the winter. There are people who don't have enough to eat or they don't have access to healthy food. In my town of Peoria, one of our grocery stores chains, Kroger's, decided to close the two grocery stores that remained in the areas where the poorest people are, saying they just weren't profitable and they couldn't keep running them at a loss. And so now we have food deserts in our town of Peoria, and of course we have to figure out how to solve that. There are probably 1,000 other worrisome things happening just in the United States of America, things for us to worry about, people to care about, people to worry about. And how we respond to that says everything about who we are. We have a choice. We can say, it's all just too much. I can't pay attention to all of this. I can't care about all of it. I don't have enough money to donate to all of it. I don't know what I can possibly do to make a difference, and I'm just done worrying about it. I think I'm going to go over here and do whatever my hobby is, fill in the blank, and forget about the world. That is a reasonable response if you're overwhelmed and you just can't anymore, to just say, I need to take a break. I need to just go detach. I need to turn off my Twitter account, turn off my Facebook account, and whatever else those social media accounts are that everybody uses, and just stop paying attention for my own self-preservation. But some of us are practically incapable of doing it, of just saying, no, I can't listen anymore. We're obsessed. I know somebody who responds to every one of the president's tweets. Me. And the more I paid attention, the angrier I got. And the more I responded, the nastier my responses got. And the less happy with myself I became. I finally had to stop and think about it and go back to what I want to be, which is a kind and compassionate person. And I had to find it within myself to think of the leader of the free world as someone who is worthy of my kindness and compassion. And you know what I remembered? Everyone is. There are no exceptions. What right do I have to make exceptions? I don't have the right to put him outside. And then I returned to Thich Nhat Hanh, my teacher, and that wonderful, challenging poem, I am the sea pirate. I have to see myself in the people who are making me angry. Admittedly, it's a little hard to see myself in Kim Jong-un with his funny haircut. And I don't know enough about him, but I know he's still a human being, and so I have to see myself in him too. I have to see that I have a choice to make, that the disengaging or the deeply engaging are both sides of one coin. They're both within me. I can disengage appropriately, but I can engage appropriately. What I discovered for myself was the angrier I get about politics, for instance, the more I feel the emotions of fear and hatred and anger, and the more those emotions control me, and the less effective I become. We all suffer. That's sort of the root of the understanding in Buddhism, is that we all suffer. That's what life brings us. But how we choose to suffer and what we do with our suffering makes us into better human beings. How we deal with suffering. We have a choice to take our suffering and transform it into something better, or just feel more suffering and let the anger and hatred build up. Another true confession: I really hate racism. And I really hate how people practice racism unconsciously. Really, really hate it. And my singular pet peeve is how segregated we live in the United States of America. Now, granted, we can say, oh, there were all these previous policies that previous governments had where there was redlining and people couldn't move into certain neighborhoods, and there was covenants saying no one of this particular group can move into this neighborhood. My husband's Jewish, and when we bought our very first house, after we decided to buy the house, we were reading through the actual deed to the house, and in the deed to the house, it said, no Jews may purchase houses in this area. No Jews may purchase a house. And then we look deeper. The developer was a Jew. And yet he was willing to create these deeds that said no Jews may live in this neighborhood. And of course, that wasn't being enforced anymore, but probably it was in the early 60s when that housing development was built. And here we were living in it. I actually checked into whether or not we could have the deed rewritten to take that ugliness out, and no, in the state of Michigan, once a deed is created, it's there permanently. It's simply not enforced by law. So those things still existed, and those things are part of why we're segregated, but we're also segregated by choice. And one of the ways we do this by choice is that we say, oh, I can't live in that neighborhood because the schools aren't good. The schools aren't good in that neighborhood. That's what we tell ourselves. So my precious children can't go to school where the schools aren't good. And that's what we tell ourselves about why we want to move to the neighborhood where there are only white people and only white children, and our children end up in school with only white children. That's what white people say to themselves. Now, everyone who says that to him or herself denies it. We all say, no, it was just about the schools. It wasn't black and white. It wasn't poverty versus people with money. It's only about the schools. Well, guess what? Science has proven us wrong. It turns out that schools that are integrated by race and class, all of the children do better than in schools that are segregated by race and class. So even our precious white children that we are so worried about because we can't put them in bad schools will do better in those bad schools than they do in their perfectly lily white, well-funded schools. We've proven it over and over again. We know it's true, and yet we decide to set science aside just this once to protect our white children. Okay, so you can hear me. I'm like being mean and nasty, and I'm being very judgmental, and I'm really hating on white people a lot, and I'm feeling like I'm like superior to them, and I'm just really full of rage. And I say these things out loud in public a lot. And it makes me an extremely ineffective activist. And I know that. And somehow I can't seem to stop myself from saying it, because it's, first of all, it's true. I'm speaking the truth. We have good science on this. You can look it up. We know it works. But convincing people to take that leap of faith that their children, who all of our children are precious to us, right? That their children won't be extremely harmed and their academic progress stilted and their chances to get into Harvard ruined by becoming the valedictorian. So these things that we tell ourselves are true, the things that I'm telling people are true, but that doesn't make it helpful for me to say it the way I say it. What I'd like to do is transform my message into a more loving, accepting, palatable, sweet-voiced message. And so far, I haven't done it. I did it again just a few weeks ago at a public meeting, and my friends like tried to shut me up, and I'm like, no, I'm gonna say it. It didn't help anything. What I'd like to do is be like the man whose name I forgot to look up. There's this man who's African-American, and he decided that he wanted to have a dialogue with members of the Ku Klux Klan. And he started with just one, and just listened, and asked questions, and listened some more, and asked more questions. And by listening, and listening, and listening, and asking more questions, eventually his first interlocutor gave up his Klan membership, and literally gave his Klan robe to this man and said, I'm not gonna need this anymore, do something with this. So this man, does anybody know his name?
I don't know his name, but he's got a show on television.
He does?
He's a musician.
He's also a musician, yeah. So I feel terrible, I forgot to look up his name. But so he started with one Klan robe. I think he has over 200 now. And he goes and he listens and he listens. He listens people into love. He listens them into love. He talks with them, yes, but he listens. And people give up their Klan robes. Now, I want to be more like him, so I'm going to have to find out more about him and study him harder and see if I can become as awesome as he is. So, in the meantime, until I become awesome, I have work to do. And I'm going to invite you to try doing some of that work too, because you might also be as awesome as the guy with the Klan robes, but you might also be struggling like I am. Being an ineffective activism. We don't want that. We want effective activism. I think you're having workshops in the future about that. And I'm sure you'll learn a lot, and I hope you'll all follow those examples and not mine. So one of the ways we can do transforming things is to fix ourselves so that we're more open and loving in our responses to the things that bother us and less angry and full of hatred. Anger and hatred rarely result in people doing what you tell them that you want them to do. And you know, one of the other stories I remember from long ago, I saw a video of Mr. Rogers' neighborhood, talking about how his mother taught him to deal with terrible things that happen in the world. He had asked her, you know, about something he'd seen in the news that was disturbing, and she said to him, Fred, find the helpers. When you hear a story like this, there's always somebody who's helping. And figure out who those helpers are. Sort of like, you know, the Monkey King helper saved his little tribe of monkeys. So Fred tried to use that message in everything he did in his little TV show that was so transformational for me as a child. I mean, I was lucky enough to grow up in Pittsburgh, so I saw it from the very beginning. I was actually not the target age when he first started. I was a little older, but I had little siblings that I used to watch it with. That's my excuse. Because his messages were so wholesome and so fulfilling and so full of love and acceptance. So find the helpers. And now that we're adults, it's our job to be the helpers, right? We're the ones that should be looked up to be the helpers. We're the ones who can be the first responders. We're the ones who guide our children. We're the ones who can make the world a better place, a safer place, a place where our children can grow up happily, not segregated. So there's this way in which we can be helpful just by doing direct action, you know, actually going and housing the homeless, actually going and feeding the hungry, actually taking our cars and driving people to the stores if they live in a neighborhood that is a food desert. So my community is working on solutions to the fact that Kroger is closing two stores, and some of those solutions include us just taking our cars and saying, you know, meet at a certain place and time, there's a church that's organizing rides, and we're going to go start giving people rides to the grocery store. Our city bus system is being asked to make special runs just to other grocery stores on a regular basis, on at a time and place that everybody's going to know about. And there are people looking into trying to find other grocers who might reopen those stores in those locations. It's a challenge, but it takes a community. So in addition to direct action, sometimes that's not going to be enough, but what we have to do is change our systems. All of these actions in social justice activism are available to us if we are smart and have figured out how the system works and how we can intervene in it. You know, elect better people, once they're elected, hold their feet to the fire, make sure that they're actually doing what they promise, those sorts of things. We all know that. But until we deal with the hatred and anger inside ourselves, we're going to continue to be less effective activists. I used to write letters to my congressmen that were full of diatribe kind of words. And one day he finally wrote back and said, I don't know if he was the one who responded, but somebody wrote in handwriting on the form letter, "If you're nicer, we'll listen more." And I thought, I don't know if that's true either, but it wouldn't hurt me, right? So these, I'm like, this True Confessions Day with Valerie the Bad Activist. The one and only solution that I know of for me to become a better activist is for me to practice more loving kindness and more compassion, not just with the people that I easily identify with, the victims of problems, but also the loving kindness and compassion toward the people who are perpetrating the bad things. Now, why would I bother with all that? Because it'll make me a better person. There's this, there's a concept in Buddhism called tumbling, which essentially it's a give and take idea, so that the more I practice my compassion toward the sea pirate, let's just use the sea pirate from the poem as the example, the more compassion I actually practice toward the sea pirate, just in my own consciousness, and when I think about the sea pirate, I think, what a terrible childhood that person must have had to make this person so mean and so greedy and so ugly and so violent, right? What a terrible life that person led. Nobody should have that life. I should think of this person with loving kindness and compassion. I can't think of anything to actually do that's helpful with that person, but I can think in loving kindness and compassion thoughts, right? I can think of how sad it must be to live a life that gets little respect from some people, very little respect from many people, almost no respect from anyone who counts. So the more I do that, I think the better I will become at offering that same loving kindness to everybody that is closer to me, that I really can reach out to, that I can do something good for, and I can do it not to make myself feel better, but so that that person has less suffering. I mean, every time I take things to a charity and give them away, I think about the person who might pick that up and reuse it. I don't give junk. If something's broken, I throw it away or fix it. But if I am giving, I give the best I have. Just because I already read that book, I can give it away, right? Someone else can read that book. I can give away clothing that just doesn't suit me anymore. I can give away household items. I can give away things and give, just yesterday I gave a coffee pot to somebody who broke his, you know. Just giving things away that you have in abundance, why not? So those things help fuel me and my compassion and looking for ways that I can be helpful in giving. I don't eat meat, but we feed people on Saturday mornings at the humanist. We have the Peoria has a humanist organization, and we feed people on Saturday mornings, every Saturday morning. And I bought the bacon. and my husband cooked it up, and we served it to people. He came home smelling like he was full of bacon. Didn't eat any of it. I don't eat any of it. But people who are undernourished need bacon, like, or other things like that. Things with high fat content, high calorie content. If you live in a food desert, you need more food. I don't judge them. Even though I chose to be a vegetarian, I'm not going to judge anyone else. So I give even when it's not something I would do for myself. That's called the platinum rule, by the way. The golden rule is do what you would do to yourself. But the platinum rule, which is even better, is do what that person needs or wants, right? My husband and I are very different. When he's sick, he wants to be left alone in a dark room and don't bother him. When I'm sick, I want tea and someone to, you know, put a cold cloth on my head and fuss over me. So if we practice the golden rule with each other, we would both be unhappy, right? But by practicing the platinum rule, I leave him alone when he wants to be left alone, and he brings me tea when I'm sick. So these are the things that we can cultivate within ourselves through various methods. Buddhists encourage you to use meditation to do this, and there's a gazillion meditation methods, and you could learn any one of them if you really wanted to. But you can also pray, or you can just sit and think. And sitting and thinking works just as well as all the other methods, depending on what your goal is. But if what you want to do for yourself is cultivate more compassion, the best way to do it is to think about the people who anger you, the people that you feel anger towards, and that you really wish would maybe have an early death. Those sea pirates, those are the challenging ones. Because in spite of all that they did to others or are doing to others, somewhere along the way, there was a deficit of compassion in their life. Some deficit happened at some point. We can't correct that now, but we can keep thinking of them in loving ways. And who knows what the power is if we collectively did that? Science is starting to hint that the power of our mind is stronger than we used to think. I strongly encourage you to go use your favorite search engine and look at some of the data that's out there now, what scientists are finding out about the ability of the brain and sharing things from one brain to another. So imagine all of us spending some time this week meditating, praying, or thinking quietly about the sea pirates that we know about, the sea pirates we don't know about, and sending nothing but compassion and love in their direction. I wonder if it could change things. I don't know, but Martin Luther King believed it could change things, so I'll end with this. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. May we all know that in our hearts, practice it each day, and go forth and show the world. Amen. Thank you. We came up with a name. It's Daryl Davis. We all should be like Daryl Davis. Okay. Yes.
I think it's Camille. I think it's Camille. And the show is United Shades.
Oh, United Shades of America. W. Kamau Bell. Love him. Yes, he's on CNN. I think it's a Sunday. It used to be a Sunday nights. Yeah. The Color of Change, or the change. What's the name of his show?
United Shades of America.
United Shades of America. His shows are awesome. He's the bravest man I know. Okay, Daryl Davis and W. Kamau Bell.
Our closing words this morning come from UU Minister Gary Kowalski. With faith to face our challenges, with love that casts out fear, with hope to trust tomorrow, We accept this day as the gift it is, a reason for rejoicing.